Jeffrey, you made one of the biggest films coming out of Trinidad and Tobago in recent times. And I'm not just trying to chain you up. It really is an awesome film. Welcome to Warlock. Just tell me how the film came into being. How did that idea come into being?
Well, first, I want to tell you thanks for the way you appreciate the film, right? The film came into being, what should I say? I say by coincidence, because we were always trying to do it, but spontaneous. Mm-hmm. I recently bought my new camera, a Sony VG900 next. And I went out to test all the low light situation in the night. And my two main actors was Junior McIntyre and Raphael Joseph. They dare me to start a movie. Well, one time, the night, I tell them 9 mm-hmm. in the morning, what time is set for 6 o'clock? Mm-hmm. And they came out about 9, but they came out and we started. We shot the gambling scene first. Mm-hmm. And then Wayne Bennett, who played the role as Wayne in the movie, he came up while we were filming because I posted it on Facebook the night that I was at the film and he came up. And he was the third character to come into the movie. Mm-hmm. I just asked him what side you want to be, if you want to be on the good side or the bad side. Mm-hmm. He said, I'm going to be on the good side, I will last longer. so I placed him as the protagonist, right-hand man. Mm-hmm. Right, so that's how the movie started, and then we went inside, we watched, we shot that, the scene by the gambler, the scene by the Maxi, where they was arguing with Wayne, Ratty and Machine, where they were scrambling scene there for the money and thing. Mm-hmm. We shot them two scenes, and we went inside, and we watched what we had. And we decided, well, we're going to make a serious movie with this. Mm-hmm. But we just do a lot of short things sometimes, and we just do it, and we don't reach further because I did lack of resources and then thing. But they say we're going to serious with this, and we proper trailer. We shot some more scenes, proper trailer. And the trailer made a lot of people come in. Yeah, people started seeing them on the arc, and then we brought a team from Mova and Lavender so we merged the two communities into one.
So you put up the trailer before you even developed the script and knew where you were going with the film?
Yeah. When you bought the trailer, we died what we had. Mm-hmm. We bought the trailer, that's all we had. Mm-hmm. But what we do with our film to make it easy, mm-hmm. and when you do an improv film, the better way to go is to shoot in sequence.
Okay.
Like just as a whole, it's going like, we try to shoot scene after scene after scene, so,
right.
we wouldn't have a continuity problem.
Right.
So scene after scene after scene, mm-hmm. all we have to do when we come to start back is to get people to look
right.
as identical as they were in
of
the
course,
last scene,
of course.
Which wasn't too successful in that moment to come to Warlock, but,
right.
but people didn't complain about that because mm-hmm. sometimes the scene said to me, they'd be alone and they'd see the time, whatever it might be. But those things minor contingency when it comes to a good movie.
Mm-hmm.
Because we just see good movies all day and it's have that continuity.
Of course.
Even Jurassic Park, that big movie, and all that, right? So the most important thing, what makes that film a success, is the feeling that the movie, the emotions that the movie portray. Mm.
And it's real, it's very real, it's very straight.
The acting was on point.
Yes, it was.
The directing was clinical too, because I know my thing, but I just need to pick up myself. Mm-hmm. And the story was a really nice story too. We ended up with a nice story. From where we start off there, because we had to soften it down at the end, we had to make it grimy. We had to soften it starting. When I see what we had, I said, we had to create a family, we had to create a life for the star.
Mm-hmm.
So that was all we brought in, his grandmother, his niece, who happened to be my mom and my daughter.
Right.
And then we brought in, I see Wayne as a friend, and we create Ratty, little pussy.
Mm-hmm.
We started to make Ratty look bad one time from Inception, you see Ratty looking thing. We see the guns, first thing you see Ratty is guns and drugs, and the cash transaction. So one time we don't know what Ratty stand for.
Mm-hmm.
So all while the gamble going on there, and they seen the cut eye, that he watching my cut eye, then see it could be dangerous for Machine, because Machine is a good guy, and he go on a gangster, and he winning his money, gain him talk, and just the cut eye alone could talk. Sometimes in acting, it's not about what we're saying, you know. Sometimes it is just be a look, or a smoke, or a snare, or these simple things. Sometimes I just tell my actors and them, acting is not always talking. Because why you call it acting, they still talking, you know. It's acting, your action is more than we're seeing. I mean, you're delivering your action. Once you acting good, you will deliver your dialogues good.
Let's talk about the storyline. For those who haven't seen the movie, for those who have no clue what we're talking about, it really starts off on a simple premise, which is a card game that's just gone very badly. Now, build from there, because from my perspective, It tells you how simple a war, a beef can start up just from something that goes bad. Just from something that's considered to be a disrespect.
I know a man with a murder case because he bought doubles and he didn't like the doubles, right? And he tell the man something and the man will give me a chance and he kill the doubles, man, right? I know an ex-man. A lot of murders that happen in this country for really, really simple thing. A man do like how you're walking, a man do like how you're dressing, you're looking nicer than him. He could get a talk to instigate something. There are a lot of petty things that be causing most.
Thank you.
No problem. You're welcome there.
Yeah.
A lot of petty things that be causing most of the beef in the ghettos. And there's only, they try to paint everybody as gangsters in the ghetto, basically. And that's a wrong concept. I want to state clearly that in my cast, we don't want no gangsters in this cast, right? The general was a gangster a long time, right? So and a lot of these fellas, even in them, when I was doing my thing, I never used to influence youths into things. If I meet a youth man who done anything already, it would not be no problem with me. I would try to pull him in and try to look after him and make sure, because sometimes them you tell them, there's good youths, but you don't know why they end up in that life. And with the right pulling in, because I see a movie, and a movie is life. At least my life is movie, so movie is life to me. I see a movie where the gangster man pulled in a little youth man who wanted to be a bad man, and pulled him in, and started banning him from the gangster thing, and telling him, boy, you too bright, boy, go to school, and make something out of that youth man. You understand? So sometimes, it's how you deal with them, you tell them, hey, get them to be around here. Because I don't know. I will see a youth man, a youth man will come into my program, I will see all the bad habits because I know them. And the cast will have no tricks on me, I know all the tricks. So I see all the bad habits, I will allow it. I will allow it at a time and gradually try to game off it. It's like a drugs. And that went to a rehabilitation center for you're going to rehab and they gradually game off it, right? So I think that we know what we're doing, we come to deal with the youths and them, right?
But how did I
back to the story, back to the story, any question asked, right? Right. So from the gambling now, we decided we're going to back it's a time for action, because our concept in movies is that we cut with it in action. So it's an action film we come out to make. So one time, two men get away, thing looking to happen. I ask my character, I just ask my character sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes I ask my character. So when they ask me, one next? I say, I mean one next. So if that happens, if the man break here, you're a gangster. It's like, what are you do? I said, right, let me go on. How are you the process? Let me go on. Think, let me check the part and let me get the gun. And we create the story on spot because we actually,
that's what makes it real, isn't it?
It's wonderful to be on spot watching us make a movie. And when we make the next movie, Marcia invited. Come and see how we're doing it. We got an actor interview while we were doing this film from Mr. Just from The Guardian. And he did a nice little job on us, but newspapers interview,
right?
So you can already see it live now. So you only explain, but to be filming behind the scene with us, believe me.
How does a man with your colorful, let's use the word colorful, past, right? A kind of rocky past, as you have admitted. How does a man like you learn to make films, to direct, to do audio?
I make films since I was small. I was just living it. Right? Because when I said do my thing, I always do my thing in style. When I gamble, when I hustle, when I crime, because as I say, I was a gangster, I was a criminal, right? So I did crimes. And when I did my crime, I did it in style. And I had plenty of people say, well, we're going to cut a film. Cut a film, because, and I hope plenty of you doing this. And because now it's different, now it's not. Men are done hustling, looking for money. Men, it's just pure beef. So when a man says, go and cut a film now with a murder. And they're doing it in style.
But where did you get the equipment from? Filmmaking is really expensive, and very few can access the equipment.
I want to pick up the National Carnival Commission. And Mr. Don Sylvester and Mr. Clarence Moore, the whole commission, National Carnival Commission team, Mr. Alison Dumas, chairwoman there. Recently acquired this year due to Warlock. Okay, we made a lot of sacrifices this year, and I said we refused the NCC contract, otherwise the movie could have crashed. With the absence of me, then I could get weary, and I could never tell what could happen there. So got a contract last year and the year before from the NCC, and I used that money to purchase. My cameraman from there, I was getting other jobs and I just take my money, see how humble the studio is, we have a big studio, and I get money, I try to put it back into the mission.
But I'm still going back to that question, who taught you in the first place? I'm asking that because I'm sure a lot of young men and women would like to get involved in filmmaking, would like to have access to video equipment, and which is very, very expensive. So how did you, with the past that you have, even access a camera in the first place? And who taught you how to use it?
The first film we make was a camera phone, right?
Okay.
But right after, I was to go and work on a rig. Right? But Jenna Lincoln was a surety job. Mm. Nice money, you're going offshore and thing. And I see a thing in the TV. Do you want to make movies? If you want to make movies, come to this thing. Mm. I said, what? I said, why me are going to take that
the rig job?
No, I had to take a safety thing to go with it. The safety course, health and safety course. I take that all the money for. I take that money and I went and take my camera and lighting course.
Oh.
My studio 27 or something, so engineering happening from Jason Riley, the first man that officially taught me everything in the camera. It was basic.
Mm.
Compared to what I really know here, but it was important because I understand why it's a short size. And I understand when they show you how to edit it, and it's just so easy to put together everything. I said, boy, so easy to put together everything. I said, what? Mm. And I just started doing my thing one time. And after the camera phone, we entered the team, because the team that's contributed was the biggest patch up for in the hood.
Mm-hmm.
Men come and say, boy, that camera phone now, boy, everything, boy, they rent two cameras, then my David film view, and we rented. They made small camcorders for one something. Cheap little camcorders, petty quality, DV, but this we come and do in the hood now, that thing, what? Well, we went to kind of deal cutting with Guile and things, but it didn't come true.
Mm-hmm.
And then after we did a couple of things with that, and then we did one with. But there are a couple of projects with people, but most of them didn't come through. Because I don't want to go into nothing personal here, but certain, a lot of people who don't know a lot of things on the set, they want to try to control sets. I think I proved that I could control a big set. And I could control myself, I could control if I got a set with crane and trucks or sliders and the works. They will see a Hollywood movie because I study Hollywood camera works master course.
Mm-hmm.
I study the master course and I have it clinical instinctively that I could shoot a movie on spot. I could just say, call a camera, I could start a movie now.
Mm-hmm.
How easy that movie will start. And when we're in the shooter scene, we don't move a storyboard, we don't move it. We don't have a clue. The day when the guardian man come up here, we go out there, we don't have a clue which scene we're going to shoot. I said, well, according to who we see, only we go have to see what scene. And when we go out there, we get certain men, I said, right, we could do this scene. And we put them there and we create the scene and spot because we didn't actually know the plots in the scene. We didn't know the outline point. You understand? We didn't know what we want to do there. We didn't know it. Like the morning after, and two of them had to link up and they're going to pass. But like the dialogue and them kind of thing, those things was actually created on spot, as I say. Do it.
I have to talk to your cast members about how the realness of the dialogue, because the dialogue was supremely, I mean, that's real street. That is
going offshore and thing. And I see a thing in the TV. Do you want to make movies? If you want to make movies, come to this thing.
Mm.
I said, what? I said, why me are going to take that camera?
The rig job?
No, I have to take a safety thing to go with it. The safety course, health and safety course. I take that all the money for. I take that money and I went and take my camera and lighting course.
Oh.
My studio 27 or something, so engineering happening from Jason Riley, the first man that officially taught me everything in the camera. It was basic.
Mm-hmm.
Compared to what I really know here, but it was important because I understand why it's a short size. And I understand when they show you how to edit it, and it's just so easy to put together everything. I said, boy, so easy to put together everything. I said, what? Mm-hmm. And I just started doing my thing one time. And after the camera phone, we entered the team, because the team that's contributed was the biggest patch up for in the hood.
Mm-hmm.
Men come and say, boy, that camera phone now, boy, everything, boy, they rent two cameras, then my David film view, and we rented. They made small camcorders for one something. Cheap little camcorders, petty quality, DV, but this we come and do in the hood now, that thing, what? Well, we went to kind of deal cutting with Guile and things, but it didn't come true.
Mm-hmm.
And then after we did a couple of things with that, and then we did one with. But there are a couple of projects with people, but most of them didn't come through. Because I don't want to go into nothing personal here, but certain, a lot of people who don't know a lot of things on the set, they want to try to control sets. I think I proved that I could control a big set. And I could control myself, I could control if I got a set with crane and trucks or sliders and the works. They will see a Hollywood movie because I study Hollywood camera works master course.
Mm-hmm.
I study the master course and I have it clinical instinctively that I could shoot a movie on spot. I could just say, call a camera, I could start a movie now.
Mm-hmm.
How easy that movie will start. And when we're in the shooter scene, we don't move a storyboard, we don't move it. We don't have a clue. The day when the guardian man come up here, we go out there, we don't have a clue which scene we're going to shoot. I said, well, according to who we see, only we go have to see what scene. And when we go out there, we get certain men, I said, right, we could do this scene. And we put them there and we create the scene and spot because we didn't actually know the plots in the scene. We didn't know the outline point. You understand? We didn't know what we want to do there. We didn't know it. That is the morning after, and two of them had to link up and they're going to pass. But like the dialogue and them kind of thing, those things was actually created on the spot, as I say. You know, spot, you just do it.
I have to talk to your cast members about how they, the realness of the dialogue, because the dialogue was supremely... I mean, that's real street. That is street. The street that I know, the little that I know. And they put themselves out there. Do you understand? I'm curious as to how you got them to put themselves out there.
The technique, the main thing I tell them is that acting is living creatively in an imaginary world. Mm-hmm. When you're acting, everything real. You don't study me, you don't study the camera, you don't study nobody else, but the people and the objects in the scene. Mm-hmm. Right? So being black men, right, who are wrong, everything will happen, what going on in the movie, they might be instrumental in making it happen, but they're observing and seeing how the life is. And sometimes there's even me and the block imitating men. Some of my cast, everybody imitating. So it's talent, it's pure talent. Mm-hmm. So it's so hard, and they'll explain to you when I talk to them, mm-hmm. how easy it is to be really and truly.
I said to you that the only flaw, if you want to call it a flaw, is that you had to do, you're the lighting director, you were the director, you were the producer, you were the cameraman, one and two, the first AD, everything that there is in a crew, you were that person. And therefore, I guess technically it would have suffered to some extent. And I was asking you why you didn't try to solicit funds from the film company and other funders so that you can, you know, put post-production, you know, up the production and send it to the world, because it's an excellent film.
The film company have a security outside for Jeffrey Alleyne for false reasons.
Did you threaten them, Jeffrey?
No, that's a lie. Okay. That's a lie. I don't need to threaten the film company. Mm-hmm. I don't threaten nobody. Mm-hmm. You see, it's a kind of word games they play in with that threaten and that attack, right? Because if you make, they like to use them offensive words to make it seem bad. Like if they make a film. And you say, well, all right, you say, you tell me the lighting and things wasn't so good in my film. Mm-hmm. I know that, and I understand that, and I accept that. Mm-hmm. And I like the fact that they could, if I didn't see it, you'd remind me, but I didn't. Mm-hmm. I know that, mm-hmm. right? So, that criticism, I mean, I'm doing art. Art is subject to criticism. Right? Anybody can do anything. I could probably see this one and say, look at this nice thing here. This is art.
Well, I'm critiquing it, you know. I'm critiquing it, essentially. I'm not trying to...
But in a positive way. So I can understand that, and nobody can... But when I make a comment on any product that anybody make, they say, I'm attacking the product. If I... As they talk anything negative, you're attacking the work. And that alone will hurt all creativity in China to be... Well, anyway, that kind of concept is governing something, that you cannot watch something and give honest opinion. You have to see that a man... To be friends with people, you have to see that, all right, them thing good, right? So I want to be part of that. So I was rather outspoken to the brand, but a man that attacked people work. And from there, you know, I went to the film company and I went considering certain freedom of information documents, and they gave me some terrible attitude, which was them fault, because somebody bring freedom of information document to your organization, you have to give them pleasant. It all had to come under some guidebook under that, which right now, long time Dali in that area, so I forget the name of the book, but I have a handbook for the FYI and how you have to deal with somebody who requested information like that, and they never treat me in that manner, and I never make no issue with that or whatever it might be, and what somebody went and do is to lie and say that, I come down threaten and say, I will bring my boys if you didn't get in. I never went there for nothing. I remember the film company with application the last time, I think it was 2010 or sometime there, and I got refused when somebody who did the application the same way Timothy Timal followed the two thing. I said, I didn't want to apply. He said, boy, apply, Jeff, you apply, boy, they must give you, boy, you real good. They must do. And he followed the two form, and he just signed up to thing. He put all the information, and he do the same thing like me, and he get through, I get blank. Right? Then now, I come and do a film named Steel Pan Story. It's total discrimination I'm talking about here. Steel Pan Story, I did this film, I get about $2,500 to do this film at about 18 minutes short film. I shoot it, edit it, direct. Basically everything, me and my nephew, what the gaffer, see my little lights and my little whatever it might be. And somebody come and use that film and go to the film company and get a grant for $100,000. But Jeffrey Alleyne can't get a grant. Mm-hmm. So I can't go back to the film company for no grant, to be honest. I belittle myself.
Is it because you're too street, you're too real, you're too hood? What do you think? You think it's class discrimination?
I think it's the kind of products. The film company have a reputation for making or sponsoring products for big money, but not connecting with the people. And they see Jeffrey Alleyne, another man, could make products to connect with the people for small money, mm-hmm. right? Or for, well, lower budget, right? Mm-hmm. And it's no secret that it's a hustle. Anyway, to have free money gainway, as somebody from the film company posts in same 2010, that application, I can remember exactly last year I applied. Free money. It was not free money. Mm-hmm. All money has come at a cost, mm-hmm. right? So, as I say, when it's a free money gainway, it must have bubble and friend and favoritism, mm-hmm. what's going on there. And that is exactly what I've been a victim of. Mm-hmm. A click on top there, where when jobs come out of the TTFC, you're seeing when they watch the credits, most of the production had most of the same set of crews, same set of team. Because when they get a job, they send it by certain people, they recommend who to go and do it, and they recommend the friend of them. They recommend nobody to Jeffrey Alleyne. They mm-hmm. tell people Jeffrey Alleyne is a criminal. Jeffrey Alleyne, the people from Golden Girls get away so often, or we trail or something, I was told. Well, this is hearsay, but I see what I was told. And when they investigate, they were told that we is like gangsters and whatever it might be, the reason that people to trust and to be along. And but at the end of the day, that can't keep you back. Because the people are trying to be like Warlock. They like the stars in Warlock and they want another production. Like Warlock or better. Well, not becoming better than Warlock. If you feel Warlock good, I tell you later, take all the time. Right? Warlock is just spontaneous. And we just plan it. We just shoot with script and it's how you're acting as real as that. Mm-hmm. So then you will realize, no, it's not men just acting on spot. It's men who read a script, understand what they're doing and delivering. Because we had a kind of performance too. Mm-hmm. You understand? So that's how we come in next time. I ain't going to mention the movie we come in with yet because it could change. We have options right now. Mm. So
Tell me why you haven't benefited financially from it, because that's one of the problems as well.
Piracy. Mm. The pirates and them. Mm-hmm. Pirates and them make we famous, but they hurt we financially right now. Right now, welcome to Warlock Warning at a loss. So people inquiring about the percentage. Right now, they're really a new percentage because we're trying to set up outlets, so they're not costing money to go there. And the money that it costs is not the money that's coming in, the outlets are them selling. Like sometimes you have 10, and then the full section of DVDs, the cast volunteer to sell it, and most plenty of the cast didn't come in, cause and I understand it because mainly the job working and men was under pressure financially, so they tried to balance. They was hoping that it would swell up and get big, so they kind of utilize things for their own thing, hoping that whoever might be on the inside will compensate back. And as street men and block men, I understand that, and I not totally no feeling that I understand why that happened there. And we start our next technique now, where we set up 18, 20 of a distribution outlet. 18 distribution outlets we have out there right now with DVDs. We have Jersey selling. We have another Cinderella selling also too. That's our chairman put a quote coming out of the value of the Youth Film Academy, right? So we're setting up something.
What about the film festival? Have you tried to submit it to the film festival at least?
Well, the film festival and the film company is partners.
Okay.
Right, I want to be honest, right? The film festival and the film company is partners, and even the UE film film program, that's That is the three organs of the film industry in China and Tobago, right? And the link really, they knit up real close. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So submitting in the film festival, I feel I might have a little complication. I might get through and we got a complication. I'm trying to keep out a complication. Mm-hmm. When we start off this movie, if I ask my actors and them, if anyone was directing the camera or the answer one time, I ask them, our plan was to make this movie, put it on DVDs. We knew the pirates would have hit me, but we didn't expect them to hit you so fast and so hard. But that means because the movie good.
You didn't expect it to blow up.
It's real good, right? So we watched it as a positive. So we plan to sell some DVDs, make some money fast among ourselves, share the percentage, and hope that Sony or Paramount, Pedro, one of them, see us, see the film, because I happened to shut up about 2 years on the sheets and DVDs, and then they both started and they enhanced it and put it on the big screen. So we still have that hope and that dream there, it's alive, and if it happen, we come with our next film soon. So that was the technique, but just as I tell you, they hurt me, they attack me like we bust today, but tomorrow, the pirates are going to come out the next day.
Yeah.
So they must be all right too. They must have made the first special order online from earlier when they see the trailer. But they put the scene and I get one time on the order and they think, so when they deliver it, they have to deliver it in a pirate. So
you told me that Valleywood Video Productions is not just about making a particular film, but that you are trying to nurture the young people. And in a climate like this, Jeffrey, where there are a lot of communities, hotspots that are warring with each other, You understand? Picking up guns and killing each other for nothing. Well, for what we perceive to be nothing. A disrespect, a woman, a gamble that's gone wrong. That is an important facet of it. How do you... Are you going to use just film to do that? Are you going to use music to do that? How do you intend to nurture these young people?
Well. After Welcome to Warlock, why did Welcome to Warlock? I introduced Sariki, was kind of, his team was done on the radio. But I introduced a new artist, the former Jalano.
Mm.
And everybody liked the music.
Mm-hmm.
It's One Love, is the name of the song. That's the song track at the end of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And it's on the radio right now, so anybody can request it anytime. Mm. It's on most of the radio stations.
Mm. Mm.
And with how people see, because Alan was a little man who, but he had music in Thailand, but he recently started to sing.
Mm.
And how people see that kind of thing, what happened so quick, and the music done on the radio, and then, you know, a lot of other artists now coming in now,
okay.
The music. So right now, I kind of caught up with a lot of music dealings right now, where we have a cadre artist, we have Jaja, we have Jelano, we have Empress Goodness,
and we
also have Junior B. Junior B is Latif from the movie. So Latif from the movie is a singer also too.
Okay. Right?
And if you want to hear Junior B, just check out Inna the Ghetto, it's on the Warlock rhythm.
There's a Warlock rhythm?
Yeah, it's a Warlock rhythm by Zingali.
Okay.
Zingali, Lion's Den
like
Studio. Studio. I'm King
okay.
David. King David and the,
right.
King David and the Warlock rhythm.
Right.
Kushite.
Lovely.
I think the man from Southern Maliki. And I'm Caracal. And Jelano and Junior B, who is Ratty.
So it's a whole kind of empire. It's not just a film.
No. It developing. This is something I didn't cater for. Last month, I didn't know that all this music business had been going on, right? But it happened suddenly, right? People, they made the Warlock with them, and they asked me if I like it. I tell them, right, go ahead, and we do our thing. And these artists had them on the Warlock with them. And that big name we call them, because King David is a big name.
Well, I know, but
Karakir
yeah,
is a big
yeah,
name.
Yeah.
Kushite is one of the best really female artists locally.
Yeah.
I don't know the Maliki youth man, but he had to be good, because he sung good.
Mm-hmm.
And I listened to the song, and then we had Jalan, who now coming out, but good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with that combination with Junior B, who is Ratty in the movie. So
mm-hmm.
so it's things happening, right? And then Ratty B have a surprise to them. Come independence, I go tell them what it is. Right? You have a surprise to them coming around the corner. So a lot of things happened. We were doing library last Saturday, praise the Lord. The whole entire performance. People like it. We have it up on the YouTube too.
Mm.
Welcome to Warlock in library.
This
nationwide tour.
This is a question that I had a I don't want to say heated discussion, but it became a heated discussion because I took a particular position. Somebody said to me that, well, don't I think that the film is encouraging violence? Because in some communities, there are young men now who want to be a rat, who want to pick up a machine gun, and who are glorifying the violence. And you could look at it both ways. You could look at it at the point where, which is how I looked at it, that it, to me, should deter you from violence, because look at the end of what, look what happens. Mm-hmm. Ratty dies. No, there's nothing good that comes from it.
Any youth man want to be a ratty over a movie? He brings that in the right order, right? Because you see what going on with Ratty. So nobody really want to be a Ratty at the end of the day, right?
They love guns, don't they?
No. But what I see really and truly with the youth and them out there, they glorify the Ratty and the machine, but they don't want to be them. They're getting kicks off of the characters. They realize that these characters is not really the junior market, these people. Because when they meet Ratty and machine and them in the streets, Ratty's a soft-spoken guy. When the gays are meeting, well, Ratty's so soft. Ratty just talk soft, always smiling. Machine and a man, when they approach the machine and blushing. I don't be getting kicked over them, I don't, because remember they don't know my face so much in the movie. So I don't be getting kicked over them when I move with them.
Yeah.
And it's a nice thing, because if you see my jersey here, right? This jersey is how much years ago? 5 years ago. This is from Wet in the West, right? It was when we popped the trailer for Wet in the West. And
Creating stars
one by one, right? And also we have creating stars in abundance, and we have creating stars, not gangsters.
Right,
those are our
right.
slogan from inception. He opens an opportunity, closes a prison door. That way we start off on, and that way we're trying to create for the them. And it's happening because a lot of communities, I don't love it, where we make a movie, Enterprise, where we make a movie, Maloney, where we come up in Maloney, Council, Sam calling for we up there. And a lot of people calling for we who in nice little community groups and things. So I don't think that the film had a negative effect on the country. I feel it's a positive effect, whereas these youth and them who imitating the Ratty and the machine them in the block is more kicks. I was in Tobago. And I want to big up the Kong Paul little team there, right? I was in Tobago there. And it's men on the block. They're imitating all the characters. The woman that come and make a movie there too. And I am going to Tobago to make a movie too, right? This year, later on in the city, we're going to Tobago to make a movie. And unlock, link up already. You don't know my Belgian, right?
Yeah.
So. These youth men I'm imitating, and you are like, you don't like, you know, Rasta man selling cigarettes and paper and everything there. A youth man go on there now, because imitating, a youth man go on there now and saying, I tell you, I'm a boss here and take a lighter, right? So here the Rasta man, put on your gun now, you can't find the only gun you can take off. So it's Wiley, so everybody had a favorite character in the movie, and they're getting kicks. Nobody ain't using that to go and do no violence. Men doing that and people can get kicks because they like the characters and them.
Yeah.
When people see Ratty and Machine and Wayne and them all day, right now, it's like a mad scene, I tell you, I just had to go there. And I do with them, and I go by myself, and I go on business part because I got to stop, then pity. If it had to happen, I would do it because I'm trying to be a polite people, right? Because that is part of the whole business. You can't run from people and take pity. Okay, who wants to take a picture? Me, I always take a picture, right? And that's how the whole team has been moving too. But I do like that kind of shine up thing, but I don't get kicked off when you move in because it'd be too much. Right?
Valleywood Youth Film Academy.
Valleywood Film Academy. I will never see the sunshine to talk Valleywood Film Academy for you.
Well, tell me about the overall premise, right, and then we'll talk about it.
Valleywood Youth Film Academy is one of the little affiliates we're doing things with the children and them, right? It's a non-profit organization. Whatever funding we're going over there and extend that and thing, we're trying to create something over there what could be a revenue own and generator to keep that floating on the own. Because Valleywood Video Production is a business. It's two different concepts, right?
Right.
Valleywood Youth Film Academy, we have youths there who with us, but Sunshine is the leader of that.
Which is your daughter?
Not because she's my daughter, because in one concept.
No, I'm just checking that. No, who's who? Right.
But the reason why, because as I saw her on the internet just now, since Sunshine is 7-8 years, Sunshine all day and she's doing monologues and she's performing a national monologue competition and coming second among big players in the game. I'm talking about adults and things. She and Cheyenne Mahias was the two little youths and things, all them big people they respect. We come to monologue and this type of thing, right? In that time. And so since then she into that, and then since she acting in almost all value production and she does deliver. And she understands because she hopes that certain things will come into the actual production level and writing, script writing and these kind of things, which she understands certain things. So she deserves that position, not because she's my daughter. She was my daughter, she didn't get that position, she was my daughter, and she wasn't qualified the next person to get that position. Because the thing with Valleywood, we do try to put a square peg in a wrong hole. You won't get no progress there at all. And so a lot of problems with people who square peg, who want to go in a wrong hole. And because that waste of time, because the whole production, or your whole mission could fail because of a square peg in a wrong hole, right? So Valleywood Youth Film Academy last year we had a camp. We trained, they tell us 50, but we trained 78 youths.
Nice.
At the end of that, they made 3 short films.
Nice.
And they're on YouTube. The best one out of them is Violence Dopey. It's a 2 minutes one.
Nice.
And the production value in it, nice. It's the best production value and the nicest story.
Mm-hmm.
And this year, from August 11th, we're about to host our second annual camp.
Mm-hmm.
In collaboration with the College of Water and Science and the Ministry of Arts and Multiculturalism.
Boom. I love it.
Yeah.
What's next for you? Tell me, talk to the youths. Talk to all the young people watching this. Talk to the men who are picking up guns and killing each other for simple things, for not a lot, and filling the jails, mainly black young men. Talk to them. Tell them something. Leave them with something, Jeffrey.
Right. My brethren, Olya, it's time that we check yourself and see what we're really doing. Right? Because I know situations where cousin kill cousin, brother kill brother, and we have to come to a level, right? It have And there's plenty of talented youth out there doing that. There's plenty of little footballers frustrated because they're not getting the opportunity, mass here. Yeah. It's all going on, they're not getting the opportunity. But Valley would come to create opportunity for you, number one, right? And we come to lobby on any level. We need to control our violent thing. We make welcome to Warlock to show you how to bust nobody's car like the buses in the movie, right? Because it's all kind of foreign movies, all kind of action. We make that to show all you how easy friends, because Ratty and Machine was partners, right? Wayne and Machine was bridging. Dangles was riding with Machine and all of them there, and with Bullet and everybody, right? So, and that's exactly what went on with me, right? Now, the reason I decided to leave the gangster thing, honestly, is when the killing get reckless. When I started to see my brethren and them, started war with my brethren and them, I decided I no place for me, right? Because it become a deceitful game. And that is the same kind of thing I'm playing, you know, right? It's time for me to rewind that. And let me come, and let me, instead of doing it, let me act it and make money, right? Because if the right kind of people and corporate people, let them come on board this kind of thing, trying to be go. Or let her jump out. This is right now like how it have the Hooper life, like how it have the sport thing and whatever it might be. Film is what the youth's liking right now. Everybody want to be out there. We're on social media. I'm not bashing the football and the sports or whatever it might be. But right now, social media, everybody want to be out there. And that they want to be out there. And even these fellas and them who right now want to be hiding from police and whatever it might be. And the government, bring them to me. All who wanted, bring them in. Give them a clean slate and put them in Valleywood. Let me create it for them.